Comcare's webinars bring together a wide variety of people from across the Comcare scheme and those from other work health and safety jurisdictions. For those of you attending for the first time, thank you very much for joining. And for returning attendees, welcome back. It's great to have you all with us today. Now, today marks World Day for Safety and Health at Work and Workers' Memorial Day. This provides an opportunity to reflect on how to prevent occupational deaths, injuries, diseases, and illnesses, and to remember those who have died from a work-related injury or illness. The theme set by the International Labour Organization for this year's World Day for Safety and Health at Work is Act Together to Build a Positive Safety and Health Culture. This theme encourages workplaces to foster a strong work health and safety culture in which everyone contributes. As the National Authority for Work Health and Safety and Workers' Compensation, Comcare aims to promote and enable safe and healthy work. And our functions include responding to incidents, including those of a psychosocial nature, educating the jurisdiction on ways to prevent and manage workplace hazards and risks, and encouraging leaders to foster a positive workplace health and safety culture. Comcare strongly believes that an integrated and holistic approach that focuses on prevention is necessary to improve outcomes for individuals and workplaces. While this approach is not an obligation for employers under the Commonwealth Work Health and Safety Act, it should be seen as better practice. We encourage you to consider today's presentation within the context of your organisation. So our guest speaker today will discuss the benefits of an integrated approach. He will outline the characteristics of successful workplace programs and provide practical applications for addressing the most difficult challenges facing your team. We are extremely fortunate to have renowned expert Dr. L. Casey Chosewood present today. Dr. Chosewood is dialing in from the USA and on what is his Wednesday evening. Dr. Chosewood is the Director of the Office for Total Worker Health at the National Institute of Occupational Safety and Health, part of the Centre for Disease Control and Prevention. He promotes the protection and improvement of the safety, health and well-being of workers through research, intervention development and partnerships. From 2004 to 2009, he served as the Director of the CDC Office of Health and Safety. His office led numerous CDC workforce protection programs, including all occupational health services, laboratory, environmental and biological safety programs, as well as workplace wellbeing and prevention initiatives. Prior to this, he served as the medical director of CDC's three occupational health clinics. Dr. Chosewood received his MD from the Medical College of Georgia and residency in family medicine at the University of Connecticut. Since 1997, he has served as Assistant Professor of Family and Community Medicine at Emory University School of Medicine, and he received his Master of Public Health in Health Policy and Management in 2014. It gives me great pleasure to welcome Dr. Chosewood to present today's webinar.
Greetings, folks, from the United States. It is really my pleasure to be here. Justin, many thanks to you, to Comcare, and to the Government of Australia for inviting me. It's quite a pleasure to be here. I must tell you, it is 9 o'clock at night. It's well after happy hour. So you guys are in for a wild ride. And I want you to think of this as just a great conversation with my friends down under from the United States. So again, thanks a lot for having me. My goal today is really to talk about the total worker health story and to really make the case that investing in the total worker health approach, this integrated approach to worker safety, health, and well-being has benefits, not only for individuals, clearly there's a goal there, but organizations, governments, and our society as a whole. So with that, let's get started. You know, a couple years ago, it was my custom to say to folks that work is changing dramatically. It's just changing at this very, very rapid pace. And then all of a sudden, COVID-19 hits And perhaps that statement that I had just made was the biggest possible understatement that anyone could actually utter. Fast-paced change, which was sort of the baseline, all of a sudden turned into full disruption of the way we actually work. With each new variant of the coronavirus, the issues and challenges mounted higher and higher. The spike protein, if you will, of COVID impacted every aspect of our safety, health, and well-being. For some, the pandemic was feast or famine. Some people worked no job at all. They lost their job. They had no sustainable income. Others worked more than they had ever worked before in their lives. Think first responders, healthcare providers. So this feast or famine of work completely disrupted the way that we existed day in and day out. We had high levels of stress, uncertainty about the future, fear for our own safety, our own well-being, our own health. Caregiving took on new meaning. Homeschooling became full-time work. Our interaction with technology dramatically changed. So it would really come as no surprise to you that with the onslaught of the pandemic, one truth really emerged strongly. Work and our relationship with it is extremely influential to our own health and well-being. Many of you in your positions now are on the front lines of protecting workers. I saw the list of attendees and know that many of you are squarely in the lane of providing occupational health services, human resources services, government services, regulatory services that are essential to the functioning of your nation and your economy. So it's no surprise to you that your job has become more complex in light of the global pandemic. Work has always been a significant challenge because of its risks directly for injury and illness. And that, obviously, while it may be improving in some metrics, there are still plenty of jobs that carry excess risk with them, both traditional and newly emerging occupations as well. Work is also where we earn a living. It's where we get our main source of sustainable income. So, and we know that wages in general are a very strong predictor of health outcomes. It's almost linear. Higher wage workers in general have better health outcomes for the most part. And those workers at the margin in lower wage jobs typically do far less well when it comes to their health and well-being. Where we live, how we commute, when we get married, how many children we have, do we have a cat or a dog? Those are all strongly related decisions to the actual work that we do day in and day out. We're also introducing this concept of time poverty. And especially for those workers who need more than one job to earn a living, all of that work, all of that time spent in actual employment means there's less time left over at the end of the day for other important pursuits, for other rest, enjoyment, socialization, building relationships with friends, families, loved ones. That time poverty that exists, especially among those with multiple jobs, is a significant drain on health opportunity. And it really reminds us that lower wage workers need a higher intensity of interventions when it comes to health interventions, safety interventions, and overall well-being programming. If we want better equitable outcomes, we have to invest more in those workers who are paid less. I mentioned the work influences around relationships, families. In the US, work means access to healthcare benefits. That's not true in many other countries around the globe. But in the US, not having a job or having a poor quality job often means no access to affordable healthcare. And we know in our country that that very lack, that risk factor alone, can decrease longevity by up to a decade in certain demographics just because of the lack of healthcare insurance. So it is no joke when we say that work and our well-being are inextricably linked. Because of this truth, Total Worker Health recognizes the porous nature of work and the rest of our lives. And it really was why we founded this approach to integrated work, safety, health, and well-being. Total worker health first, at its core, at its baseline, is first and foremost about keeping workers safe. You cannot have a total worker health program if that is not an essential component of the program. We then add to that element beyond keeping workers safe to comprehensively integrate the three P's of total worker health: good policies, practices, and programs that actually grow health among workers and contribute at the end of the day to their overall well-being. There are a number of essential elements that create a total worker health program, and I'll just go through a few of them now. We talked about the importance of protecting workers. One of the best ways to do that is not really to add more personal protective equipment or harden workers so they can withstand more challenges through resiliency building or work hardening programs. The best way is to redesign work so that you have built-in protections with the way that work is organized and designed to begin with. We call it designing healthier work. Get rid of as many hazards as you can, and then move to make the work experience better. You need strong leadership commitment at all levels, especially that frontline interface between management and line staff. There's something called a participatory approach that's also essential in the total worker health model. It means that workers have a voice, they have agency, they have control over both identifying and solving the challenges that they are encountering day in and day out. Certainly, confidentiality is important when you blend work and non-work issues, as is critical in the total worker health approach. And we're also going to tell the story of how integration is a key component here, using the wise words of one of your own countrymen to make the point. So what do the three P's in total worker health actually look like? Total worker health policies, programs, and practices. And again, some of these will resonate with those of you who have occupational safety and health responsibilities. Others on this list will resonate more with those of you who are responsible for human resource policies or wages or benefits. Others in the employee assistance program, mental health programs, will see yourself represented in these three P's as well. And that is by design. The best total worker health program joins the professionals from occupational safety and health, workplace health promotion and mental health, employee assistance programs, human resources and benefits, because those are the things that matter to workers. Those are the most important influences when it comes to producing high quality health at the end of the day. None of these are rocket science, but they all play an important role, according to our research, in improving well-being outcomes. Worker centricity in all its many forms, from problem solving to trying to plan and strategize, not only on worker safety issues, not only on health and well-being issues, but on production issues and profitability issues and strategic planning and decisions. Giving people that voice and that agency is essential to a meaningful, fulfilling, engaging work. People want to do good with the employment they have. At the end of the day, if I can go home and say, I've made a difference about something that I care about, my work experience will improve. My health will improve. People often ask me, who is most critically important in the health of a worker? Some people say, well, it has to be the safety office. Some people have to say, oh, it's probably their personal physician to make sure they get their screenings, they're taken care of. My answer, according to our research, is that the frontline supervisor is far more influential in someone's health and well-being than their personal physician will ever be. And it's because this frontline supervisor can make or break the work experience for an individual worker. And because of that, many of our total worker health interventions focus on training supervisors in better people skills, communication skills, softer skills, better listening skills, better reward and recognition skills. That is where the rubber meets the road and where you need the highest trained people persons in jobs of responsibility when it comes to supervising people. Again, in a nod to our roots in worker safety, you'll recognize the traditional hierarchy of controls here has been modified to examine the total worker health approach. So this shows that a credible total worker health program is based in primary prevention that seeks to eliminate hazards that workers face first, then substitute health enhancing policies, practices, and programs, the three P's of total worker health, redesigning the work environment so that it is supportive of worker safety, health, and well-being. And only after those three large, more powerful, more influential interventions are done, do we move to the less effective, individually focused training, the educational programs, and lastly, encouraging personal change. It isn't because personal change is not important, especially in things like stopping tobacco use or maintaining a healthy weight. It's that the things above that are far more powerful influences in determining long-term health and even in the success of some of those individual level interventions. Let's talk a little bit more about this power of integration, if we will. So what are the benefits of integration? This comes from one of your own countrymen, as I mentioned, Professor Anthony LaMontagne of Melbourne's Deakin University. He's a professor of work, health, and well-being. He reviewed 90 important studies in the field of total worker health and integrated approaches to health, safety, and well-being. And he showed that taking a comprehensive approach to job stress interventions, something on the top of your to-do list, my guess would be, he found that that comprehensive approach to job stress interventions that emphasizes individual and organizational level interventions are more powerful. First of all, if you just look at health outcomes like mental health and blood pressure, individual and combined approaches had about the same positive impact, but one was short-lived and one was long-lasting and more sustainable. And clearly, the individual and organizational change had far more reaching, far more longer-lasting impact. And if you look at organizational outcomes like absenteeism, productivity, and injury risk, individual change-only interventions performed poorly when compared to combined individual and organizational level interventions. Three times more powerful when you take the integrated approach. This is a lengthy list, and it reflects our relevant issues in the total worker health portfolio, and where we also see gaps in the literature and in the research where we need to do more. All of these represent areas where you can intervene into a total worker health approach. All have dramatic connections to worker safety, health, and well-being. We've arranged them in 10 or so topical areas to help you drill down into areas that we feel are extremely important. If you visit our website, just by Googling NIOSH Total Worker Health or Total Worker Health, you can easily find research, recommendations, policies, programs, and practices on all of these areas that we show here. I'm going to shift now to talk in our last half about some of the challenges that my guess is your workers are experiencing now, really raising the red flag that they're under stress and duress. And one of the ones that we hear most frequently about is this interplay between work, the complexity of demands on workers, especially around technology and how it impacts their mental health. I think the stakes could not be higher now, especially with all of the external pressures and economic pressures facing operations day in and day out. The pace of change, the demands of increasingly complex technology, often without workers driving the train of that technology. They're oftentimes an afterthought instead of a centerpiece of technology-related decisions. There is a mental health price to pay for that decision-making and risk for workers that their health and well-being will suffer or will not keep pace with the demands that are being placed upon them. Would it surprise you to know that between the invention of the printing press to the light bulb, it took the span of 400 years? But now a major technological innovation occurs every month, every week, certainly every year. We have dramatic demands on the learning curve of workers. The total worker health approach to accelerating technology is just as I alluded to before. Workers must be at the center of decisions around technology use and not become subservient to them. That's a major challenge. Workers are not able to keep pace, oftentimes, at the same rate that artificial intelligence can evolve. And it will require continuous reskilling and retraining at a pace that is acceptable. It may even mean that we delay certain technological innovations until the human in the robot-human artificial intelligence interface catches up. And I would argue that that will be critical, finding that balance between technology and the ability of humans to evolve to keep up with that technology is an important balancing act to get right. Change at work is at the center of all of these technological forces in our research program around the future of work. And if you'd like to read more, look at our great webinar series on the future of work and dive deeper into this topic. We examine the entire scope of all of these drivers of the future of work and examine ways they can be optimized to safeguard the safety, health, and well-being of workers. So you can Google NIOSH Future of Work or NIOSH Total Worker Health and reach our Future of Work pages. In addition to the COVID-19 pandemic, the United States is facing another serious epidemic. Would it surprise you to know that in the city of San Francisco during 2020, the height of the COVID pandemic, in the U.S., that city had more overdose deaths related to opioids and other drugs than deaths from COVID-19. Overdose deaths and the pandemic are driving a syndemic, a co-occurring set of epidemics, each feeding on the other. And this comes on the heels of many years of increasing deaths from drug overdoses in the U.S. Now, you may ask the question, why is someone who works day in and day out in work safety and health talking about drug overdoses? There's another shocking fact when it comes to drug overdoses. There are dramatic differences between industries and occupations and rates of drug overdose deaths. And that is why this quickly becomes a work issue. Construction workers in the U.S. have 5 to 7 times the death rate from drug overdose death than we see in the general working population. We also see high rates in service workers, in mining workers, and oil and gas extraction workers. These workers are at higher risk than the average worker when it comes to drug overdose death. So what is it about this connection between opioid use, misuse, and the risk factors for overdose death? Well, certainly not having a job at all is a risk factor. So if you don't have a job, or you don't have a job that's secure or dependable or predictable, so what we might call insecure work or precarious work, that is certainly a risk factor for drug overdose and for death. Having a bad job, one that predisposes you to injury or illness or other painful conditions, having a job with excess hours and lots of work demands that causes chronic and unrelenting pain or fatigue, that oftentimes can lead to either injury that might require pain medication prescriptions or pain medication usage just to be able to get through a painful or uncomfortable situation. In fact, we have strong evidence that the entry point to illicit drug use in the United States is not marijuana or some lesser worrisome street drug. The entry point into illicit drug use is oftentimes a prescription, a doctor-prescribed opioid. And that connection is strongly related to those industries and occupations where we see higher rates of occupational injury and illness. There again, think oil and gas extraction or mining or construction, high risk, high injury prone occupations. We also know that the lack of certain benefits, like paid sick leave, for example, can drive drug use, misuse, and opioid overdose. Paid sick leave is important. If I have a job where I only go in to get paid, and if I stay home sick, no paycheck, I may take a pain medication just to make it to work every day. We also see, as I mentioned, not only dramatic industry and occupational differences, we see regional differences in the U.S., certainly education-related differences, and wages, another predictor. People who have low wages have to work longer hours, more prone to injury, more prone to exposure to painful, difficult working conditions. So part of our total worker health portfolio is drawing dramatic attention to the challenges of drug use, prescription drug misuse, overdose risk, and overdose death. We have a number of important interventions developed for workplaces that want to improve their response to opioids and to drug use of all types, especially looking at issues around impairment, safety and drug use, drug testing, and also workplace supported recovery. We know that helping people stay at work and get better with substance use disorders is a critical part of their lifelong recovery, and work needs to be part of the solution with someone with substance use disorder. Another hot button issue that probably impacts your workers quite a bit these days is this interface between work and family, or work and the rest of life. That fit is increasingly important. This is a pretty important young lady in my life, my granddaughter Lily, who just turned 9 last week. And she always reminds me when I'm working too much. She says, "Pop-Pop, I know when you're online because you don't call me or you don't text me." So she reminds me about the importance of work-family fit. And I'd like to remind all of you as well to the fact that your workers are struggling with this issue more than ever before, especially because there's this challenge around when we stop working at home and when the rest of our life begins. Would it surprise you to know that many people wake up in the middle of the night to check their workplace email on their handheld device? It is not uncommon. And I want to encourage us to give permission for folks to actually separate from their work and not continue it on into the evening, even though they're only steps away from their office with at-home work, quite common. The challenge of work-life fit is perhaps most magnified in those workplaces where wages are low. And this slide reminds us that with a smaller paycheck becomes many greater risks and woes for workers in this pay range. The effort-reward imbalance is massive. Some workers, especially those on the margins, may not have safety protections. They may experience wage theft. Discrimination is common. Safety materials may not be presented in their language. They have forced overtime, often job insecurity. Discrimination may be part and parcel of their work. We know that that this is pervasive in the lower wage worker. In the US, this represents 1 in every 3 workers. And as I said before, total worker health interventions need to be increased in frequency and intensity based on wages. Wages need to say that this is a red flag, a warning sign. And for those folks on the lower pay band in our organization, they're going to need more intensive services, more intervention around safety, more frequent intervention for well-being interventions and health promotion interventions and screening opportunities. You don't need one size fits all for everyone in your organization. You can heavily invest in those parts of the organization that are at higher risk for poor health outcomes. And I would encourage that as a very important part of the total worker health approach. This is a study from our well-respected American Psychological Association that our institute works closely with, and it looks at the stressors faced by essential workers, those on the front line of the pandemic. 1 in 4 essential workers in the United States has been diagnosed with a mental health disorder since the start of the pandemic. In that just brief 1-year period of time that this survey examined, compare that to about a 25% incident rate over a lifetime for serious mental health diagnosis, all concentrated in that 1 year because of the stress of essential work. More than half relied on unhealthy habits to get through the pandemic. 1 in 3 say their overall mental health worsened, even if they did not rise to the level of a diagnosis. 3 in 4 said they could have used more emotional support during this time. Compared to essential workers were twice as likely to have a formal mental health diagnosis. they were three quarters more likely, 75% of them, had unwanted weight changes. 80% said that they were sleeping either more or less than they desired to sleep, and 40% said they were drinking more alcohol. All of this is a red flag for organizations that have high numbers of essential workers, again, showing an important demographic where you need to intervene more aggressively, more regularly, more intensively. As we start to wrap up, we'll just look at some of the evolving psychosocial and organizational work hazards and effects. We've mentioned some already before. This is really where the risk is. Underemployment, low wage, lack of security related to work, this blurring of work-home boundaries, work intensification seen especially in essential workers during the pandemic, loss of social connections and loneliness, something that we also see in remote workers at all wage ranges, and effects on dignity, the meaningfulness of our work and our purposefulness. All of those workers started to question with the dramatic shifts that are underway. Folks, these represent all places where you can send reassuring messages and develop programs and practices that encourage intervening on all these levels. So with all these challenges going on left and right, all these hazards, all these woes, all these pain and pressure points, isn't it time for us to do a better job of creating worker well-being? We believe that an essential component of well-being is to safeguard the mental health of your workers. The best employers will seek to protect and improve mental health through these approaches. We think this is just as vital as keeping workers safe physically, because your mental and emotional health is a critical part of your overall safety. The cost and toll of not doing this, the long-lasting effects of not addressing these approaches, is going to be extremely important. I'm hoping that we can talk a little bit more about mental health approaches in our Q&A section today. So there's an emerging science around this concept of healthier or supportive supervision, and it actually shows in our research to be perhaps one of the most powerful ways that your organization can intervene on behalf of the well-being of your workforce. We need to train those important frontline managers and supervisors, all of those things I mentioned before, softer skills, communication skills, listening skills, empathy skills. These are critical in order to make an important difference. We have excellent training available around supportive supervision, and I invite you to take a look at it on our website. We've also developed an important tool. If you don't measure well-being and track it over time and do it pre and post intervention, how do you know you're making a difference? So we've developed a new survey, 68 items, takes about 15 minutes to complete. It's the first comprehensive measure of worker well-being, and it looks at five domains. It looks at workplace, physical environment and safety, your workplace evaluation and experiences day in and day out, the policies and the culture, your health status, your personal health status, because we know that weighs into overall well-being. And lastly, your connection to home, community, and society. This is a free survey. It's ready to go on our website. It's been validated, tested, pilot studied. We really encourage folks to take a look at the NIOSH WellBQ, stands for the NIOSH Worker Wellbeing Questionnaire. I will wrap up with just saying that as work is changing, our discipline, our academic field of occupational safety and health must change as well. All of the elements that we've talked about today demand a new professional to keep changes or to keep pace with all of the changes that new work and future of work will involve. So I ask you to think more about the vertical exposures workers have that they carry with them over the course of a working life, and the horizontal exposures, those interactions they have between home, work, and the demands of their job day in and day out. We're also committed to training new folks with these total worker health skills that understand the connection of all these things. And we have a number of training programs and funded research centers to actually develop this professional of the future. I mentioned our research portfolio. It is conducted in 10 university centers of excellence for total worker health across the country. So from Oregon Health and Sciences University to Harvard to Johns Hopkins to the University of North Carolina, Colorado School of Public Health, all across the nation. We have a number of centers that are producing great trainings, free toolkits, free interventions, as well as really high quality research. Please take a look at all of them. They have great websites and wonderful resources. I'd also point you to more than 50 total worker health affiliates. And these affiliates are folks who are really committed to being our learning, living laboratories to help us understand how this is perceived and it works in the real world. These are nonprofit organizations, academic, government institutions, our own workforce at CDC follows the total worker health model, and they're one of our affiliates. And this is how we learn about the best practices, programs, and policies, and we try them out in all these settings to really see what those better practices are. We have a textbook in total worker health. This is available digitally or in print. And it's a textbook that's not only used in our 10 academic centers, but in 6 training and certificate programs that actually credential a total worker health professional. So if you want to take a deeper dive on total worker health, the textbook will allow that. I will close just with a word of thanks and an invitation to stay in touch with us. Feel free to join us on our website, subscribe to our quarterly newsletter. We promise not to spam you. And everything we do is free. It's paid for by the US government. So, you know, might as well take advantage of those resources. We're also indebted to all of those of you who dedicate your life day in and day out to the safety, the health, and well-being of workers. So I can't think of a better way to have spent my happy hour. I hope this has been a meaningful exchange, and I look forward to welcoming Justin back for a nice Q&A.
Thank you so much, Casey. That's an incredibly thought-provoking and important presentation. Really well done. Thank you so much. So we do have time for some questions from the audience. You can use that Q&A function on your screen. And to give the audience some time to get their questions in, let's start with a few that came to us through the registration process. So the first question, Casey, is how do you ensure that our health and wellbeing policy best supports an increasingly remote workforce?
Yeah, it's an excellent question, Justin. And even though folks are not face-to-face, they may be in two dimensions as we are, but they're not three dimensions. There is a price to be paid for that lack of just personal interaction, the warmth that comes from a smile or a pat on the back or a handshaking or just meeting over a cup of coffee. There is something lost when we as social beings cannot have that connection. So we have to work harder to make up for that loss of social connections. Two dimension is better than one. So having this face-to-face through technology that allows for body posture and facial expression and a caring posture and concern that you can show through your facial expressions is an important way. I also think it's important for us, though, to do more than just speak or just to be seen next to each other. Folks need more flexibilities. And because that work and home interface is so intermeshed now, so connected, people need the flexibility to take care of home when home demands and work when work demands. And having more day-in, day-out flexibility is going to be important. Increasing buy-in, the participatory approach, as we mentioned, letting workers solve the problem is another thing to add. Asking folks how they want to be rewarded or recognized so that you actually are giving them the things they need. And in addition to adding a few things, take away some things as well. Take away their technology woes, the barriers they have at accessing services, the red tape that oftentimes comes with employment. Try to take away as many of the pain points as the things that you add in.
Okay, that's excellent and very much aligns with some of the duties and obligations under our Work Health Safety Act, I should say, too. What are the main barriers for organisations investing in and or implementing an integrated approach focusing on mental health?
Yeah, you know, I didn't mention one of probably the most important barriers to overcome around mental health interventions at work. One is to recognize that at least in our country, and I would assume in yours, there's still a lot of stigma around actually accessing or admitting that you actually need or want to receive mental health services. And the way we overcome that important barrier is to talk about these issues more openly, tell personal stories if appropriate, leaders and managers should be comfortable talking about mental health, and they also should not feel they need to be expert in this subject to speak up and intervene. It's one thing to say, I'm here for you, I will listen, and then you don't have to actually fix anything. Just listening and then being quick to refer to the skilled professional who can actually intervene if needed. You will accomplish a lot just by talking about the issue, personalizing it, making it real in your own life, showing empathy and concern, and then being an open door to help someone if they need the help. I would say increasing our ability to feel comfort talking about it, decreasing stigma, increasing awareness of effective services. That includes even tough things like opioid use disorder. There are meaningful, important, high-quality interventions that do work. These people can get better and remain at work. That's certainly true for all of the underlying mental health conditions. So it's important that we feel comfortable talking about it and be quick to refer to resources for high-quality professional care when needed.
Right. That's really insightful. Now, how do you think you go about best gaining the support of senior leadership for this approach?
Yeah, senior leaders are critical. And in some operations, like small organizations, say 25, 50 workers, the senior leader really is the total worker health professional because the setting is almost like a family. So you think, well, small enterprises may have a challenge actually doing some of these things. In truth, oftentimes it's easier in small organizations to impact, to build that culture of family and caring and concern, and we're in this together and we're doing something meaningful together, and I know you and I know your family. Those relationships are extremely important. So senior leaders have to show concern. They have to show that they understand that people are under duress and they're having their challenges. But then they need to be quick with solutions as well. It's not just a feel-good thing here. We need solutions. The fastest way for a senior leader to get buy-in is to create a worker management committee. Our Total Worker Health Committee, again, brings people together from health and safety, human resources, health promotion, mental health, if you have that, all in one room. And start small. Pilot on one small project. Don't try to conquer the world in one day. Show success on a small issue, move to a larger one. Many companies start with what they call a tiger team. They bring the experts needed to solve one problem, work through that, and then that tiger team becomes a consultant to any other part or division of an agency under, you know, stress, under duress. Letting workers be part of the solution is going to be the key to success.
And just a note from the Australian perspective that there's a requirement to consult with workers under the Work Health Safety Act. So that's absolutely a requirement in there. And following on from your answer there, one of the questions that we've had from the audience is, how do you then maintain momentum when things are a little challenging to introduce in a workplace or a work environment?
Yeah, sort of sustainability is going to be critical to getting the approach right here. I think, again, you don't try to do it all at once. Take a stepwise approach. And the really a very first out of the gate opportunity is to ask workers what their pain or pressure points are. One quick way is the NIOSH WellBeQ, the questionnaire that we talked about. You can even do something faster and quicker than that. But having it confidential, letting people speak their mind without fear of retribution is important. And then when you identify where those main issues are, you think about two approaches. What can I add? But perhaps more importantly, what can I take away? What are some of the demands or challenges from that, you know, information that we've received that we need to decrease? Recall that you cannot add your way or help promote your way out of an unsafe workplace. You really need to start to eliminate where those challenges are first before you add in additional programming. I oftentimes tell our staff, we cannot do a lunch and learn on diabetes when people have 8, 10, 12 hours of grueling, you know, hard work, demanding work conditions. The intensity of a health promotion intervention is never going to overcome the challenge of 8 hours of difficult, demanding, hazardous work, for example. So you really do have to think about what you can take away to make total work health more successful and then what you can add in.
And a segue to another question from the audience. So you mentioned the importance, the influential role that frontline supervisors play. And I think you're talking also about good work design. Can you expand on that a bit for us and tell us how that can influence better outcomes?
Yeah, you know, there is one subspecialty of occupational safety and health that I really feel like is just the team player, the utility player that is so adept at introducing total worker health concepts. And that's the industrial hygienist or the certified safety professional that really understands that work design and work organization is perhaps the most critical of any intervention that can take place in an organization. These are the folks who can study a work process from beginning to end and identify not only where the challenges are, but where the human interaction with those challenges is more or less likely to lead to injury or poor outcomes of some sort or another. Unfortunately, we don't have people as skilled on the mental health side as we do on the physical health side when it comes to assessing risk. So I will put in a plug for every large organization to consider one of Dr. LaMontagne's graduates in the field of occupational psychology or organizational psychology, because those professionals are worth their weight in gold in helping design work from a psychological safety point of view. And I would say that interface of the industrial hygiene with the occupational health psychologist is a very powerful work design cohort. And I think working in concert, those two can make a dramatic difference at lowering the major risk factors, both physical and psychological.
Okay. And just to expand on that, another one from the audience. So how do you deal with the increase in mental health issues within workplaces and yet still manage to, you know, to ensure that staff are displaying appropriate behaviours and delivering productivity?
Right. And really, that is a balancing act of all of these things, right? Here's the sort of secret from my perspective, from total worker health. Imagine three companies. One is not doing their job to protect workers. Those workers go home at the end of the day with less health than when they arrived. Obviously, that doesn't meet the standard, the regulatory standard. These workers are trading health for wages. A better company will send workers home at the end of the day with the same health that they arrived with that morning because they are protecting workers. But a total worker health company, the best company, sends their workers home at the end of the day, not only safe, but with additional health benefit through those three P's that we've talked about. And those workers go home with more health at the end of the day. But the secret here is that at the end of the day, those workers go home, their family, their community, society benefits. And guess what? When they wake up the next morning, they come back to work and the organization benefits. How? Decreased injury risk, greater productivity, better ingenuity and creativity, more adept customer service, decreased conflict amongst coworkers. This really is this virtuous cycle of productivity being driven by high quality workplace design and workplace programming.
Good for business as well as good for the individual. There's an economic benefit. Is that what you're suggesting there?
Exactly. I mean, the company benefits by decreased spending on worker injury and illness, decreased employee turnover, higher engagement, improved customer service, more productivity, less absenteeism. All of these are metrics that our integrated approach through our research shows are quality outcomes.
Okay. And looking again at the Australian context, so Australia's on a journey towards improving its WHS laws. There's a reform underway that in all likelihood will result in a requirement for employers to notify psychosocial injuries that occur in the workplace to regulators. So looking at through that lens, have you got any examples of where in guidance or improvements in a legislative framework have been implemented that drives this total worker health outcome that you've been talking about?
Yeah, Justin, that's an excellent question. Unfortunately, we do not have a psychological safety standard as part of our Occupational Safety and Health Administration, and we see that as a shortcoming, especially compared to Scandinavian countries, the UK, even our neighbor to the north, Canada, with a strong, enforceable occupational psychological safety standard. So we're really interested in trying to move our regulatory authorities in that direction as well. There is an ISO standard that NIOSH has contributed to related to workplace mental health. And if you're not seeing that regulatory effort, that is a, you know, an international standards organization approved standard just last year, it really does address psychological safety and psychological issues in the workplace. I think that's a step in the right direction. In the US, it's a voluntary standard, but it oftentimes paves the road for use of the general duty clause, which is enforceable to protect workers. And I certainly applaud your efforts. And I must say, there's quite a few things we can learn from how you guys do things.
Okay, now another question that from the audience, and it relates to the personal stories that leaders have and this notion of sort of vulnerability and empathy. You know, is there a place for, is there a benefit when leaders can demonstrate their own sort of journeys and talk about their own experiences within the workplace? And is there any evidence or research around how that might improve total worker health?
You know, I would love to invite the person who asked this question to join my team, because I couldn't have put it better myself. That is absolutely the key to having strong, supportive leadership and supervision, to become vulnerable. And unfortunately, we're not given that skill set in most training programs. But when it comes to interacting, my relationship with my patients, my family, all get stronger with increasing vulnerability. We put ourselves on the same level. We are human. We show our foibles and our failures, and that endears us to others. It's also a really strong characteristic of high quality leadership that I can say I'm not perfect and that I don't have all the answers, but I'm going to listen to you, and together we're going to find the best solution that works for our business and for each of us.
That's I think that's spot on. I mean, I've seen that in my workplaces, and particularly through COVID, some of the leaders in our organization, I think, you know, demonstrating their own vulnerabilities and their own personal experiences with the pandemic, I think built greater connection with our workers spread all over Australia in kitchens and bedrooms and studies across the country. Next question sort of relates to that. So do you have any advice on how to maintain the feeling of inclusiveness for workers who are working at home, you know, particularly in the context of COVID restrictions, who might feel disconnected from colleagues and who may feel excluded or lonely by not having that interaction?
Yeah, you know, and it's a major issue. Some people do okay with not having that really strong social connection, but there are others who really thrive on the social opportunity that work provides. And in fact, we see a number of benefits of peer-to-peer supports and socialization as an important, critical piece of actually successful workplace programs. One of our centers of excellence, the Oregon Health and Sciences University, has really studied this issue in quite a bit of detail. And their evidence shows that increasing social supports, either among peers or between that frontline supervisor and the frontline worker, is extremely critical and shows tremendous benefits, not only on the prevention side for workplace injury and illness, but on the bigger measures of well-being that are being studied. So I think there is a strong argument and a growing research base to show that work is an important societal glue that brings us together and connects us. And we have to find a way to make that happen, even when we're not working in three dimensions.
Okay, probably our last question, again, from our audience. So what interventions or practices have you seen work best to enhance worker movement or physical activity, and particularly thinking about sedentary jobs, that target the three Ps that you mentioned?
Right. Yeah, I love the strongest of the three Ps is policy, because it sets the stage for every other program and practice, right? Policy impacts 100% of workers. A program, if it's good, might get a third of your workers, 10%. So policy is the strongest of the P's. Policy for workplace physical activity means increasing people's flexibility to get up and move, having a walking meeting. We also introduced a pilot program on walking workstations that allow people to do their keyboarding and their work and listening to their training programs while walking at 2 to 3 miles per hour on a treadmill. We have sit-stand desks and all of our physical locations and encourage them in home offices as well. Some people program their computer to tell them when to get up and move. We also offer programs that really cater to people of every physical activity level, from seated yoga to stand up and actually move. We do those all virtually now through the pandemic. But if I had one most powerful intervention, it would be to give people the flexibility to get away from sedentary behavior by just letting them decide when they work, how they work. Don't hold them to a time clock, hold them to meaningful outputs, but not punching a time clock or sitting in front of a screen.
Okay, well, thank you so much for your presentation and for taking those Q&As. That was incredibly insightful, and we're out of time for questions, unfortunately. There are plenty more I could have sent your way. But yeah, we really do appreciate you making yourself available, and at this ridiculous hour of the evening on a Wednesday in, I think you're in Atlanta, Georgia.
That's right.
So yes. Thank you so much. We do appreciate it. And our audience very much appreciates it. And I'm sure if they were able to, they'd be clapping loudly in this virtual environment.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to be with you. Thank you.